Now what happens is, as you're drawing on there, it's coming up, you know, like the Picasso film we saw, it's coming up magically on this screen.
Oh, okay.
At the same time, and this could be connected to a big projector.
Oh,
it could be any size, so this could be cinema screen.
Okay.
And it will just appear like the Picasso drawings.
Oh.
But it's instant, and it's, you know, it's real time.
Now that's interesting because there's a location problem here. Where if I want to do the scent, go back to that.
Yeah.
And do like if I want to do the iris, it's not where I thought it would be.
Oh right.
So that's a problem.
We might need to do the orient again. I might not have been because I stood up doing it. So if you want to just check the orientation.
No, I think I'll just stay with it and see what happens.
Okay. But I can see this being a really important tool for illustrators.
Yeah. And sort of explaining drawing as well.
Yeah.
Right.
Having used a graphics tablet, what do you think about this?
Why isn't that working? Press hard.
Yeah. Press and release, yeah. That's it.
Yeah. It's instantaneous, which I like because I think there seems to be a delay with some of the other things I haven't used very much, but some of the things I've used before, there's a delay with them. Is this pencil as well, Marie? Or
just try it. That's Magic Pen, I think. And you can get all those different ones.
Let's try that. There is, with this particular, there's a delay there, isn't there?
Very slightly.
Very slightly. It's kind of like drawing through treacle a bit. But it's kind of nice. You know what we were talking about earlier about the sort of surface tension of the paper?
Yeah.
And that sort of affecting the kind of line that you draw.
Yeah.
And there is an element of that with this, but it's not as pronounced as whiteboard.
No.
But
it's the closest thing I've experienced to using normal stuff, traditional materials.
Yeah.
Just have a look at the this tool at the end here.
I'll just get rid of this.
Yeah. I'm trying to get you up the range because Livy had it up so she could use this that range of thicknesses and range of colours,
that one.
But I can't remember how we got there. We sort of got there and we didn't know how we did it.
That's eraser still.
Oh, it's because you're still on eraser.
Do I click that again?
No, go to pencil, click pencil. Yeah, now try that one.
This one at the end?
Yeah. No, nothing's come up.
No.
You're still on eraser, so you've got to get it onto pencil first. That's it.
Okay.
That's selected.
And now on to this.
Right, now then, can you see line styles come up here?
Okay.
Click line style. There you go. Now you've got your palette and you've got your thicknesses.
Okay.
So now you can go between them, just clicking on them.
So, can I try this line style? This kind of blurry one?
No, it's these ones. I don't know what those are yet. It's these ones.
Okay.
And that one.
I'll try that one.
You could click on the selection one there to see what that gives you. That might give you different, there you go, different types of line.
So let's try that one. Oh.
And you can do that in different thicknesses by clicking the thickness one up there.
Oh, okay. Let's try that. Oh no, that didn't move, did it?
And you could do it in different colours.
I think what you see more pronounced is sort of the unsteadiness of your hand, which it records more than it would if you were doing it straight onto the paper.
Yeah. love that you can do instant things like that with it.
What a great toy.
It's that instantness that is so unlike anything I've worked with before.
Yeah.
And that it is connected pen to screen, it just seems really important. In theory, if you're really good with the graphics tablet, you can do that instantly. But it's not the same, because you're drawing here, but you're seeing it coming up over there.
Yeah, there's that delay, isn't there, in
Well, it can be instant, but it's that you're drawing here and you only see it there. There, you see what you're drawing, where you're drawing it. It's to do with this position,
I think. The eye, the brain, and hand thing, isn't it? And it's sort of that process. And if it's not, that there is a disconnect there if you can't do it right in front of you.
Yeah, I agree.
You need to play with it a lot so as not to be seduced by what it can do.
Yeah.
You know, the material side of things, because I think that's really easy to do, isn't it? Because this is fantastic.
I sense comfort.
Yeah. Can I get one? I think this is the near, as you say, it's the nearest thing to drawing.
Yeah.
And that's what's put me off using, because Photoshop can be so long-winded and you haven't got that instantaneous thing about it. And you go through so many processes, and by the time you've been through one, you've forgotten what you were doing last time and how you got there.
Mm. The thing you've got with this sometimes, if you're doing big, thick, complicated marks, which just like you were doing, complicated digitally, if you like, can you see it's still drawing after you've stopped?
There's like a drag, isn't there?
Yeah, but as long as you're then going and choosing your next thing. But if you think about the time you take after you've made a mark to go and change your brush, mix your paint, change the colour, this is still quicker.
Yeah. But I think it's great for colour as well, because you can put colour down straight away. I mean, but there's a difference between that colour and that colour on the screen as well, isn't there?
There is, and when you print it out.
Yeah. So what you're seeing, and it's all that sort of...
And if you projected it, you'd get something different again.
Yeah, yeah.
So there is stuff to look at in terms of, it's backlit, what's the screen resolution. There's a lot of technical stuff which you or I would just kind of not pay attention to much or not get into.
What would it be like if you projected it onto a mirror? Because you know when you paint behind glass and it gives you that luminosity of colour?
Yeah.
Because that looks quite washed out on that screen. But I'm thinking if you put...
Well, if you turn it to you, is it...
It's green. It's got this wash of green or yellow about it. I think that's sort of quite sharp.
That's pinkier.
Yeah, it's got more graphic... that looks like there's a wash of green over it, to me. I know we all see colour differently.
Doesn't look too bad to me. This is
See, that's more
paler.
This is a more blue pink on here, I think.
Yes, it is, and that's paler.
But I'd be really interested to see what happens to the colour projected onto a mirror, and have that the light coming through the colour again and bring in something else into it. What about if the mirror was convex?
About what?
The mirror was convex, or you could really experiment with mirrors, couldn't you? Breaking a mirror and putting it back over a flat and a different surface as well. So what would that do? Would it change? Oh, it's like a whole kaleidoscope. So many possibilities. What does this do?
That's a magic pen.
Okay, let's have a look at magic pen. Really big. Oh, candy sticks. Okay, magic pen. Let's have. But you could quite easily see how you could get carried away with... it's like a box of tricks, isn't it?
It is.
Which is brilliant. And get so sucked into
that. But it's a tool. Okay, you can doodle away, you can draw from imagination. But what I was asking was, can you use it to develop observational drawing?
Yeah.
And why would you? Why would this be useful to do observational drawing?
Yeah.
and I've done, and Livy did an observational drawing for me on it, and she just worked in, as intuitively working with the palette and the
right.
pen, and that's how she did that drawing. I stuck a bunch of flowers in front of her and she did it, so you can use it that way.
Yeah.
And
oh, look at that. Yes.
And that stops you just playing, but this encourages play as well.
And that's important.
And it's something about the interplay between developing observational drawing skills and play doodling skills of, oh, what will the medium do? What can I do with it? And then you, it's those two in tandem, isn't it?
Yeah.
And often we don't, we train artists for one or the other.
Yeah.
And I think the digital generation are growing up more trained to do this, to doodle and make, and sort of almost use the graphics, the computer graphics, to make something look or seem impressive.
Yes, it's about showmanship.
But there's no, yeah, showmanship, but there's no drawing discipline and underpinning it.
There's, it's almost like there's no spatial awareness because they, everything's flat screen and they're not working with anything that's truly observed in three-dimensional in front of them.
Yeah.
And I know certainly there's a friend of mine who's an architect and another friend who's got a graphic design company, and both have said they've had people come in, fantastic portfolio, then said, can you just show me a variation on this? And they've walked straight to the Mac. And they've said, no, on paper.
Mm.
And they can't do it.
Yeah.
And I think that's, that becomes a problem, I think.
So the thinking on paper was absent.
Yeah. And it's that eye, brain, hand thing again, which is really important.
So we could be training that out of our artists if we only
Use this. It's about going to choose the paper that you want to draw on.
When you and I in bookshops and art shops, we sit there going,
yeah,
feeling the
yeah,
paper.
Absolutely. And that you can't obviously have that with this.
You don't start feeling the screen.
No. It doesn't invite you to do that. And if there was the technology in place for it to do that, why would you do that when you can go and get paper? You know, it's sort of that taking it onto a ridiculous level.
Yeah.
I think it's a brilliant tool that should work in tandem with traditional drawing techniques.
I agree.
And I think we should still teach people how to draw.
Is there something more fundamental about it?
I think there's something more fundamental. We've always made marks.
But we're still making marks on there.
We are still making marks on here, and I think this is just another way to make marks.
Yeah.
I don't know, would you say photography was about mark making? I don't know. It's about capturing a still image, isn't it?
More about image making, isn't it? Is image making and mark making different?
Yeah.
What's the difference?
I think that image making, it's more voyeuristic, isn't it? You're an observer, and you're a doer, but it's in a different way. It's sort of like you're more connected with the materials. You're more connected. I think it's something with photography, you're stepping back, and it's not when you're out. If I was out, say, I've just went to fairs earlier, and I didn't want to take loads of photos because I felt if I did that, I wouldn't be as connected with what I was seeing and experiencing because it was behind a lens. But if I was sitting there drawing that, I would be more connected with it.
Can you pinpoint why?
It's about, you're looking through a small piece of glass and your vision is limited. You've got peripheral vision, haven't you? It's about enclosure. It's about limitation, isn't it? Whereas if you're drawing, you've still got your peripheral vision. Yes, you can turn your head with a camera, but it's not the same as seeing and... I don't know, I think for me, I can only obviously speak personally, but you absorb what you're seeing in a different way.
Would you say it's about how you see through your body, like your whole body? You talk about smelling, hearing, seeing.
Yeah, absolutely.
Would you say what you're hearing, what you're smelling would affect a drawing?
Yeah.
And would that affect a drawing? I suppose because for the... If you had a digital sketchbook, which was mobile, so obviously with this, we're sat in a studio, we've got to be connected up to electricity, so that lends itself to a certain kind of sterile environment, if you like.
But But if this was a sketchbook and you could go out and draw with it.
Would you use that because of all the options it gives you, or would you use a paper one?
I think I'd just still go for the paper one because it's more instantaneous. For me.
But
maybe that's because of the way that I've been trained, that I know if I do this in charcoal, I've got all those things at my fingertips. Whereas this, it's going to be, I've got to think about this more. But even if it was, this is still very graphic. This is still about, and it's, I don't know, and it's that separation, isn't it?
What? Separate.
Graphics and fine art or painting. And I know that, there, of course, there are crossovers. And I think there are ways that you could use this and combine this and do something really interesting with it. But I think that it's about, is it behind glass? I don't know. It's sort of that thing about being behind a camera.
Oh, okay.
That's limiting in one way. And I find that, I don't know, this would feel as though, I don't know, it wouldn't have the same feeling as working on a sketchbook. It doesn't have the same feeling as working on a sketchbook. It's fun, and you can do loads of exciting things with it. But I don't know, maybe I'd have to go out and try it.
Mm.
Maybe that's the new development, people. Not that there would be a great use demand for it, though, would there?
What?
To develop something that was sketchbook sized.
Oh, I think so.
Do you think people would use it?
Yeah, well, that's what's happening on the iPhones already. I mean, I didn't have a sketchbook with me at one point, and I needed to make a drawing, so I took out the iPhone and did a little drawing with the drawing application.
Yeah.
So, and I could see how that would do it, but I do know what you mean. There's something, when I look at the iPhone drawings I've done, there's still something, I think you put it best when you said behind glass. There's something behind glass about it. And do you remember when I talked about Howard Hodgkin and how him drawing on top of the frame made the paint sit in front of the frame?
Yes.
It was almost like he'd suddenly found a way of bringing the picture closer to me as the viewer.
Yes.
Than something that's behind glass frame, like most of my drawing works are behind glass when they're framed.
Yes.
And it's something about how to get the viewer closer as well as the maker.
Yes.
Or the viewer as close as the maker.
Look, I've put some humanity back into the line. That's the way you do it. Do you know what it just occurred to me, the way that we know that you can't fake kids' drawings. Like when you get a grown-up who tries to do a kid's drawing and make it look... It's kind of, with this, it's a machine mimicking a real-life artist, isn't it?
No, it's machine mimicking the human mark. Isn't it? It's the machine mimicking the human mark by being directed by the human mark. So it's human in that you're holding the pen, you're telling the digital pixels where to leave the mark.
Mm.
But even that, what is it, half a centimetre gap between you, between your digital pen tip and the digital page.
Yeah.
Even that gap, even though this is as close as we get to it being like drawing in a sketchbook, is enough to let you know that's machine made.
Hmm.
This is the machine made gap.
Machine made gap, yeah.
Try this, and I just want you to, you can either just do it and talk later, or you can comment as you go.
Okay.
About how it feels, whether it's connected or disconnected, and whether it's helping you to do an observational drawing.
And you're going to say that, and I'm going to draw you. Okay. Right then. And straight away there's a shadow where I want to draw your face. So I'm casting a shadow on your face, which interferes with where, because my hand is over your face. That it's going to interfere with where I want to make the mark. So straight away, I've got to reconsider which I'm not liking very much. I think what's off-putting as well, I can see myself doing it.
Do you find that off-putting?
Yeah, I do. I don't find it helpful. Because it's movement in front of your face. Oh, you've got a cat that's...
is there anything about it that is helpful?
No. No, not for me. Because
in terms of getting proportions? Or
no. Anything? Because what's happening for me is... okay, so the image is projected onto your face. That's one distraction. It interferes with my... connection with looking at you. Then I can see my hand moving around over your face, which is another distraction, and I can't get the proportions right I would like to, because there's too many things going on over there, and because there's a distraction going on over there, my attention is drawn to that and not what I'm putting down on paper.
How about if you only looked over here?
If I only looked over there, but I am mostly looking over there, and that's the problem.
And is that creating a distance?
Yeah.
That's interesting.
It's that disconnect again. It's almost like when I've been drawing from observation before, I haven't had this situation, and I find that it's the still life or the person or whatever it is you're drawing and the paper, brain, hand, which, okay, that is there, but then you've got all this movement going on over there as well, and it's interfering with what's going on here. It's almost like television. I'm trying to draw you and the television is on because there's all this movement and there's a screen. Could you look down like you... Oh, that's interesting, the ghosting of the white. Okay, so now we've got chalkboard in school.
Does that alter your experience? Or
yeah, I prefer that.
Interesting.
I think it's about the brightness of the screen, for me.
Yeah. Is it difficult looking over here at a negative and looking over there at a positive?
No. For me, this is... that was frustrating, that the previous experience, but this feels more natural.
Okay. Do you know why?
I think there's the glare of the white screen. It's too much like a television. It's almost like there's too much activity going on. This, it kind of turns it down a lot. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
there's less interference. Before, that felt like having the TV on and the radio on, and do you know, it's like too much going on, and you can't, I couldn't focus my attention properly. And I think visually it was sort of hard to, for me to plot where I wanted to put things as well. I don't know.
Well, what I'm noticing watching you is that I would say you're looking at your drawing about the same amount of time as you would anyway, if you were at an easel and just drawing them straight.
Okay.
And I suppose what I was seeing, especially with drawing the movement, especially drawing dance, is that I've been training myself to slowly ignore what I'm doing on the paper and just look at what I'm drawing and trust that hand-eye connection.
Yeah.
Try to get to more and more. But you do kind of tend, you are always tempted to want to see the drawing. You do look back, and I do look at the drawing more than I even think I do, I think.
Right.
But what this enabled me to do was to stay with what I was looking at more. So what kicks in when you're drawing observationally straight away that's different to what you were just doing?
It feels more connected.
Why? Even though you're objectifying me.
Yeah, but I know you don't mind that. Sometimes it's nice to be objectified. You'll have to edit that out.
First thing you asked me to do was to come closer to you.
Yeah.
And that's something to do with sight size, isn't it?
I think so.
Because that's something else drawing through the projector does, is it sets the scale.
Yes. Yeah. I think it sort of, you have more control. You can get what you want from it without, it's sort of like predetermined, isn't it? If you're doing it in a, it's a very stage managed way, isn't it, with a projector?
Yeah.
I think, yeah, distance is important for me with portraits. I think also, maybe that's what it was, that I was doing doing the portrait, and because it wasn't a full figure, and so therefore you need to be closer.
Yeah.
So that could be part of it as well.
That's interesting. It's spatial relationship.
And it's the sound.
Yeah. You can't hear the sound of your hand on the paper sometimes over the projector.
Yeah, I don't. I really find it, for me, it's an interference and a frustration, which I can see that how well it works in the performance because of the Cardiff thing.
Yeah, because you've got music, it's the loudest thing you hear, you don't actually hear the projector.
Yeah. Clear space for thinking as well.
Do you think also we are energetically, there's an energetic connection that goes on between what you draw, where you place yourself in relationship to it? You should do the scale, like if you're in a landscape, you place yourself in a certain point in the landscape, but then you must throw out your energy towards what you're drawing and draw it back in.
Yeah.
It moves around. And like you say, with a portrait, you want to be distant. We're about 2 metres apart.
Yeah.
Which when you do work, when I've done work with people about their body space,
depends what they're comfortable with their body space.
Yeah.
It's, you usually have an arm's length all the way around you.
Right.
So it's like about a metre. And when someone comes within that metre, if they're not intimate with you...
It's uncomfortable.
It's uncomfortable.
Yeah.
So this is about at the edge... We're meeting at the edges of our personal body spaces.
Yeah.
And and you're sort of projecting yourself through mine to me, and I'm letting you.
Yeah.
Whereas when I was over there, I'm about 5 metres... Did you say 4 or 5 metres from you? That's harder to do. So although you were actually touching my face with your hand through the projector, energetically, it's hard to throw your energy person to person 5 metres.
Yeah. And then you've got other interference as well with what's going on with... I can see myself.
Yeah.
I can see myself. It's just... Maybe it's like when the first time you hear yourself on tape, and it's, that's not my voice.
So it's subconscious, makes you self-conscious.
And it's sort of that movement as well, you know, it's...
Took me a while to get used to it, yeah.
Maria, this is an amazing idea. I must say, I tell you why it's so amazing, because it completely, if you want some feedback, frees me up from my thinking.
Why do you think it's doing that?
Because...
It's a contradiction, isn't it?
No, I'm aware that often when I'm painting or drawing, I'm thinking I must produce something nice. This, I can't be sure at all what I'm doing. And so it's, you know, as a piece of feedback, I'm realizing I'm out of my thinking.
Yeah.
And
so you're staying with what you're
but
looking
I'm in
at.
The presence. I can't really see what I'm doing.
You're staying with what you're
yes.
looking at as well, which is great. Have a go. Let me see. Have a go with
Do
it.
Do you want
on
to give
there.
Me a different colouring?
No, have a go with it like that.
What is that? Those are my.
Those are your black marks.
Yes.
You'll now see them in white. Isn't that beautiful?
I don't understand what's
try,
happened.
Try drawing.
Again.
You should see the mark more easily. Especially if you're going across the body or near it, yeah? Does that help? Because sometimes you can...
Yeah, it helps a bit. I do think the shadow...
The shadow is difficult.
Is difficult. You know, that's something that's The shadow is something.
Actually, you're not actually leaving a mark there. So the way you're holding the feather is just
working.
Not leaving a mark.
Yeah.
So
okay.
Try that again.
I think the shadow technically is something that needs fixing, because that an
it's,
issue.
You've got to kind of get used to it.
Okay.
And you start to learn how to negotiate it and work around it, but it is a problem.
Is it a problem in?
In performance can be.
But there is something that happens. Which is when you go over the 3D form and it goes into the shadow part, where there's a kind of disparity. So you're not drawing a photographic image.
Yes,
no. Even though you think you are.
You are out of control somewhere. You can't use your mind.
Yeah.
Try do another one while he's fiddling.
And that's why I think it really appeals to artists Ooh. Like us who are more visceral.
Yes, no, I love it.
Visceral is the right word, isn't it?
Yeah.
You check
yes,
on there, you
okay.
should be able to see it. Now, do you want it on negative or do you want it on black?
It's fine, it's better. This is much better.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, much better. Because I can see when I'm not.
I find that negative tool very useful. Not only does it give you an interesting image performatively, it actually helps the drawing, it helps you to see what you're drawing sometimes. When someone's wearing a lot of dark, for instance.
I think you should get.
That's fab. Aren't they fantastic? Maria, I'm smitten. Can I come again?
Yeah.
Listen, if I was in art school and I was working with
observation, drawing, sitting down, which is what I do all the time, and I sit in my class and I think, how do I free up? Because what I've done in the last 2 or 3 years is go to portrait classes.
Yeah.
And I have done very traditional with a fantastic teacher.
Yeah.
Traditional, you know, copies of Rembrandts, Van Dycks, sometimes live paintings, but just very traditional, and yeah. I have got stuck.
It is absolutely mind-blowing.
But the idea is...
But don't forget, I'm building on traditional drawing,
yeah.
ruthless belief
yeah.
that until you develop your eye, you don't move to the next step.
This is wonderful because it actually doesn't matter if he moves, it just becomes
part of it.
Part of it.
Mm-hmm. So it's living... It's a living portrait.
So for me, it's a letting go of the mind and being much more connected to the space between us. Actually, that's really what's happening. I feel more connected to the space between me and Martin and creating something. I know, I'm not interested in it looking like him, but I'm interested in it being yeah. something.
Does it free you up from the looking like?
Yes.
Even though it's observational drawing.
Yes.